All right. Now, 2 weeks ago, we looked at the parables or sayings that I've put under in the group or the category of Jesus brings the kingdom, and there are those parables that we looked at there. And then last week, we were looking at parables that I've grouped under the heading, the kingdom en route to the consummation. And specifically, last week, we looked at the parable of the growing seed, the parable of the mustard seed, and the parable of the leaven. And as I said, parables in this category, they deal largely with correcting this prevailing Jewish expectation about the coming and the nature of the kingdom of God, and with the extensive effect of the kingdom, of the kingdom's small beginning. You see that in there, that this non-spectacular small beginning winds up with this tremendous effect. Now, instead of a one-shot deal, which was the Jewish expectation, which we talked about in the first 2 weeks of the introduction, where they say the old age, day of the Lord, then the new age. Instead of that, Jesus teaches in the parables we've looked at, some others we'll look at, this is how to understand the kingdom, that there is an inauguration. There is a period of time of an overlap of ages when the kingdom of God overlaps with the old age of Satan. And then there is the consummation at Christ's return when all that is contrary to God's eternal vision is stripped out and the kingdom of God goes on as the sole reality throughout eternity. And he's correcting some of these things, and we see these ideas appear quite a bit. Now, when we ended, we were looking at the fourth and final. Well, now, that's D. That's all you get, D. That wasn't supposed to work out that way, but it's the parable of the wheat and the weeds in Matthew 13, 24 to 30, and the explanation in Matthew 13, 36 through 43. So D is the wheat and the weeds. I don't know what happened there. We had started looking at that. I have to go back just because the nerve of that bell to ring and stop me. I don't know what to do about that. But okay, let's pick back up here. And I'll say, Jesus says in Matthew 13, 24 to 30, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds? He said to them, an enemy has done this. So the servant said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? He said, no, lest in gathering the weeds, you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Now, given, as I said last week, you had a vast number of weeds. In other words, every place is going to have some weeds, right? But what was different here, you could tell that there was a huge number of weeds. So you knew this from, this is design inference. He knew an enemy had done this. You don't get this kind of weeds unless somebody has deliberately dumped those weeds in your field. Now, given the vast number of weeds that existed and how long the wheat and the weeds had been growing together, trying to pull the weeds out of the field at this point ran the risk of harming the wheat. So what he tells them, and he says, no, what you ought to do, let both of them grow up together. And then at the harvest, you'll go, it'll be obvious what the wheat now, and with the mature darnel weed, you'll be able to tell them apart. And what we'll do, we'll then pull the weeds and the wheat. So we'll burn the weeds, and we'll take the wheat in as our crop. So this is what the parable is about. Now, Jesus explains the meaning of the parable in response to the disciples' request. And this is one of the few parables where he gives you this detailed, itemized explanation of the parable. And he does that in Matthew 13, 37 to 43. They want to know, what's this all about? What's this mean? And he says, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed is the sons of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so will it be at the close of the age. the Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear. Now, as I said, right when we ended last week, there are many who think that this parable is describing the church as a mixed community of good and evil, and that Jesus is discouraging any attempt of rooting evil out of the church prior to God's final judgment. And as I said, while it's sadly true that the church is indeed a mixed community, it has a mixed character, it's very unlikely that this parable is speaking about that, at least not directly. You have various texts in the Gospel of Matthew that make it clear that good and evil people and even false prophets can be recognized. So there's no idea about, you know, difficulty in telling them, and that this idea. You can see that in Matthew 7, 15 to 20, 12, 33 to 37, 15, 13, and 14. So in Matthew, you see that good and evil people and even false prophets can be recognized. And Matthew records directions for disfellowshipping sinful brothers and sisters. So the idea that he's saying, well, no, we can't root evil out of the church until, I think that just misses it. That misses the point of what is being said here. Moreover, Jesus says explicitly in Matthew 13, 38, that the field is the world, not the church. He says in verse 41 that angels will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers. And he says that because in the words of Revelation 11:5, at the consummation of the kingdom, the world becomes the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. So, I mean, this is simply a way of saying that in the consummated kingdom, all sinners and all causes of sin, the things that I've been saying are all things that are contrary to God's eternal vision. These things that coexist with the presence of the inaugurated kingdom. You remember the diagram? You've got Jesus comes and inaugurates the kingdom, but the kingdom of Satan, the old age of Satan, coexists until Christ's return. Well, what does that mean? You have coexisting with the presence of the inaugurated kingdom those things that are characteristic of the old age. We have evil. And that's the specific focus here, evil people. But it is not until Christ returns that those things get stripped out of the kingdom. The parable, see, it's like the others. This parable addresses doubts about Jesus' claim about the kingdom of God. These doubts that arose from those Jewish expectations about the kingdom. No, we've got the old age, we have the day of the Lord, and then we have the divine utopia, where there are no things that exist like evil people and suffering and sorrow and all those things. This is their expectation. They thought that the coming kingdom would mean the immediate eradication of evil, the purging of sinners, and the creation of a pure community. That's what they're expecting. And Jesus is telling them the kingdom is here, the kingdom is present. So in light of his claims about the kingdom's presence, people wanted to know why the righteous and the sinners were not being separated. You're telling me the kingdom is present, it has been brought, and I'm seeing righteous and sinful just mixing and living together. Why is that? How can that be? See, why are they continuing to coexist in the world? In Snodgrass's words, the parable addressed the question, how can this be the kingdom if evil is still present? You see, when Jesus said what he said, the kingdom is at hand, and the kingdom has come upon you, I've brought and ushered in the kingdom, it raises these theological questions for people. They say, how can you be saying that? One of them, they look around, they say, we see all of these characteristics of the old age that are still continuing. Here specifically, they're looking at, we see evil people continuing to coexist. We don't see the purging of evil people and the existence of a pure community. So how can that be? So he's telling them these parables to teach them what's going on. As Snodgrass says a bit later, the primary teaching of the parable is that the kingdom is present despite the presence of evil. Okay, why does he tell them that? Because their expectation was is that when the kingdom came, evil would be removed. So he's teaching them that the kingdom is present despite the presence of evil, and that evil will be dealt with at the judgment. Donald Hagner, I've mentioned him a number of times, very well-known New Testament scholar. Hagner says, he gives his understanding of the parable. He summarizes the meaning of the parable this way, very similar to what Snodgrass says. He says, in this world, even after the announcement of Jesus that the eschatological kingdom has already begun, it's been sown, it's been planted, it's been brought, it's already underway. It's not like we don't have a seeded field. It's not like the seed hadn't been planted. Okay? So he says, announcement of Jesus that the eschatological kingdom has already begun. Those guilty of lawlessness, that is, people who belong to the evil one, continue to coexist with the righteous who are the people of God's kingdom. Now, this is how God speaks of Christians. Remember when we saw in the Beatitudes, these norms and characteristics. This is who we are to be. So he just speaks of them as the righteous. Okay, so he says, those guilty of right or of lawlessness, that is, people who belong to the evil one, continue to coexist with the righteous who are the people of God's kingdom, the church. There has not been, nor will there be, a dramatic separation of the lawless from the righteous until the harvest at the end of the age. The present age is therefore one in which human society, and so even the church, yes, it's a mixed community, but that's not what he's focusing on. That's just the sidelight of the fact that evil continues to exist in the presence of the inaugurated kingdom. They coexist. The present age is therefore one in which human society, and so even the church, is a mixture of those of the evil one, the sons of Satan, and those of the kingdom. This can result in a confusing situation, especially when the wicked seem to prosper and the righteous suffer. Isn't that true? Don't we look around in this world and say, this is God's kingdom? We're kingdom participants, and we look around and say, isn't there some ambiguity in this life? Is the kingdom so obvious to everybody? No. He goes on, he says, but the ambiguity of the present situation is a temporary one. And with the end of the age, it too will be brought to an end. Then and only then will there be a clear demarcation between these two classes of people, with each receiving their eschatological due. For the lawless, a dreadful punishment. For the righteous, extravagant blessedness. And I think that's right. I think that's exactly what he's saying. Let me give you, here's David Wenham. Wenham says, the parable of the wheat and the weeds, like others of the parables, makes it clear that the revolution of God, this is how Wenham speaks of Jesus inaugurating the kingdom, the revolution has begun. He says that the revolution of God comes in two stages, with a period of growth being followed by a decisive intervention at harvest time. Inauguration, intervention. You see? Second coming, inaugurated with Christ's first coming, second coming consummated. He says, what this parable adds to the others is the understanding on the one hand that the period of growth, the period between Jesus' first coming and the inauguration of the kingdom and his second coming and the consummation of the kingdom, the period of growth is a period when revolution and counter-revolution coexist uncomfortably together, and on the other hand, that the judgment and final triumph of the revolution will come only at the end of the age. So you and I live in this overlap of ages where the revolution is true, the kingdom is present, but so is the kingdom of the evil one, the kingdom of the world. They coexist together in this, what he calls, uncomfortably together. And then at the decisive moment where we have when Christ returns, we will see this idea, this stripping out. You see this stripping out of all that is inconsistent with God's and the eternal vision there. Okay, next category. Now, some of these, you're going to see that some of these parables, I put them in different groups and categories. Obviously, some of these parables could fit in more than one of my groups. And I may not always have put the parable in my group that you think it best fits. You might say, well, I think that one better fits in the next group. Okay. But it's because there's an overlap with some of these things. But this is how I look at it. The next group I want to look at focus mainly in my judgment on the consummation of the kingdom. Okay, this idea of consummation. And the parable I want to look at, the first is the parable of the net that occurs. This parable occurs only in Matthew. It's in Matthew chapter 13, verses 47 to 50. And it says, again, the kingdom of heaven, Jesus says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the close of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous. Well, you see that from the prior parable, so we could have put that parable over here as well. But he says the angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now, let me give you a footnote here on this idea. When we talk about the final punishment of people, you say, well, you know, literal fire and all this kind of stuff. Here's my view of it. I think there are different images that are used of eternal condemnation. I think it is an eternal, conscious, everlasting punishment. But I think these are symbols that simply portray to people it is the ultimate bummer. It is the ultimate bummer. You see, that's the idea. So whatever you do with the imagery of fire and all these things, what you cannot strip out of that is the fact it will be an experience that is portrayed as weeping and grinding of teeth. Okay? Really bad. Okay? So whatever else you do with the pictures, you have to leave the truth and the reality that it is the last place anyone would want to be. Okay, that's just a footnote. Now, the net here that's talked about, this net, this is it's mentioned, it's a vertically hanging dragnet. You see, one of these things that hangs vertically in the water, which would be pulled through the sea, either between two boats, or you could have it taken out in a semicircle and then pulled by ropes that are in. Pulled in by ropes. But it's this hanging dragnet that's being spoken of here. And it gathered up everything in its path. You know, we still have this complaint, you know, people, environmentalists will go out and say, well, you know, you're dragging stuff and you're catching all kinds of, well, this is how this thing is. It's pulling everything in. It's not discriminating. It's pulling in all kinds of things. And that's important to understand. That's what's happening here. And since Jewish law, it allowed only fish that had fins and scales to be eaten. Okay, only those kind could be eaten. You can see that in Leviticus 11, 9 through 12 and Deuteronomy 14, 9 and 10. Those without scales and fins, things like eels and catfish, that kind of stuff, you see, they would be bad in the sense they would be ritually unclean and inedible to Jews. So that's this idea. You see, so we have this dragnet that pulls in all kinds of things. It would pull in fish that were ritually edible, and it would also include things that were not, things that did not have scales and fins. And the kingdom, you see, he says the kingdom is analogous to the process, this process of net fishing. The kingdom is analogous to this process of net fishing that's described in the parable, in that just as that process of net fishing culminates in the unclean fish being separated from the clean and thrown away, so the kingdom will culminate in the unrighteous people being separated from the righteous and being thrown in the fiery furnace. How's the kingdom? That's how the kingdom's like it. Just like you have this fishing process that results in all kinds of things, and then we have a separation where the good is separated from the bad's tossed, where we're going to have the righteous and the unrighteous are going to be separated on that day. And so that's what's going on. Robert Mounts, in his commentary on Matthew, Mount says, as fish are separated in the parable, so also will people be separated at the end of the age. That is the point of the parable. So Jesus talks about this often, about what the consequences are. What are the stakes in the gospel of Jesus Christ? What are the stakes in bringing people into the kingdom? He talks about that many times. You know, and he says these things. He says this is the point of the parable. Klein Snodgrass, in his book Stories with Intent, he says, again, we must remember, I think this is so important, he says, again, we must remember, the kingdom is not like the net or any particular feature of the parable. The kingdom is like the whole process. Neither the net, the sea, the shore. You hear people fixate on these kinds of things. Well, the net is this and that. It's a story about the process. The kingdom is like the process. He says, the kingdom is like the whole process. Neither the net, the sea, the shore, the fisherman, or the vessel stand for anything. The kingdom is like the process of seine fishing. That's net fishing, this vertical net, which at the end requires separation because of the way it operates. It brings in the good and the bad. So the kingdom is like that. So it requires a separation process that one keeps the valuable and discards the worthless. That is all. The primary concern of the parable is that separation will occur, that at the end, the evil will be excluded from God's kingdom. Again, you have this concern among Jewish people, theological, how can the kingdom be present when I see all of these evil, all of these unrighteous people? And he's saying there is underway a gathering process that one future date will result in the separation that you have in mind. It's coming, but you are mistaken in thinking that now is the time for that separation. The primary concern of the parable is that separation will occur, that at the end, the evil will be excluded from God's kingdom. That is not new. That is not a new revelation. For any Jew hoping for the kingdom would believe that, would believe that the kingdom will involve a separation. He says, but it was a confirmation from Jesus that his present kingdom would indeed lead to the time when evil would be obliterated. You see, the process is in action. It's underway. The seed has been planted. The field has been sown. The leaven has been inserted. The kingdom is present. It will lead to the separation that you expect in your theology. But you are misunderstanding because of this. It is the other way. There is an inauguration, and then there is, after time, the consummation. So he's letting them know that again. The sorting does not take place until the net is full and dragged on shore, until the end of the age. Neither the time of Jesus nor that of Matthew is the time for sorting, but it will take place. The time of sorting. Now, this is the Lord Jesus Christ saying this, that there is a time of sorting coming. And so we have to deal with that. You can say, well, I don't like what you're saying. Listen, Jesus is saying that the time of sorting is coming. So mankind needs to hear that message and think about that. Craig Blomberg, in his commentary on Matthew, Blomberg says, the parable of the dragnet teaches the three-part message that God will judge all people on the last day, gather together the righteous for further service and safekeeping, and discard as worthless those who are unredeemed. Now, that's the reality of it. You see, and Jesus was not shy about explaining the consequences and what is at stake. And I don't think we should be shy about it or apologize or say, well, that's unpalatable in our very sensitive age. We should not say to people that a day is coming when they will be separated and risk eternal damnation. We can't say that. Well, to me, Jesus says it. Right? I mean, if my Lord teaches it and says it, well, then we need to teach it and say it. So I think that's something that's important. Now, the next parable, consummation of the kingdom, the workers in the vineyard. Now, this parable here, this Snodgrass considers this one of the three most difficult parables that Jesus told. So when you have somebody like that who spent so much time wrestling with these things, when he says that, that is at least a sign unto your household that an extra dose of humility is warranted in wrestling with this. Okay, because some of these things, they're tough to be confident that, yes, I've got it. I've got it. What I do, I always do, is I share with you how I understand things. Okay, so that's it. And you weigh what I say and how I say it, why I think this, and then you take that home and you do with that what you will. Now, Matthew, the thing here, the context to me, this parable, it occurs only in Matthew 20, 1 to 16. And I think the key to understanding it is the context that it appears in Matthew. And I'm going to have to spend some time developing that, and then hopefully we can get through the parable, but we'll see. But I think that's important. In Matthew chapter 19, okay, the parable begins in chapter 20, verse 1. Well, the prior chapter, leading right up to this, Matthew 19, 16 to 22, that's the account of Jesus' conversation with the rich young man. And Jesus tells that rich young man in Matthew 19, verse 21, if you would be perfect, go sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. This is what he says to this person. Well, as you know, the man went away sorrowful, and then Jesus tells the disciples in Matthew 19, 23 through 26, that it's very difficult for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. And then that's followed by this exchange between Peter and Jesus. Then Peter said in reply, see, we've left everything and followed you. What then will we have? Jesus tells the rich man, go and do this, you will have treasure in heaven. Peter wants to know. He says, well, we've left everything. What then will we have? Jesus said to them, truly I say to you, in the new world. Hold that thought. I'll be back to that. When the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake will receive 100-fold and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. Okay, Peter wants to know what heavenly treasure the 12 will receive in light of their renunciation of all things. I mean, Jesus tells the rich young man, go and sell everything, you renounce all these things, and you'll have treasure in heaven. Peter wants to know, in light of the 12, our renunciation of all things to follow you, what treasures in heaven are we going to have? And Jesus says that in the new world, they'll sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And then he adds that everyone who has renounced worldly things to follow him will receive blessings in excess of what they surrendered along with eternal life. So they'll receive 100-fold, they'll receive blessings in excess of what they surrendered along with eternal life. And then he says in verse 30, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. Now the object, that verse 30, the object to which that proverb refers is very important, I'd say even crucial, in understanding the parable of the workers of the vineyard, because the parable of the workers of the vineyard is an elaboration or an illustration of that proverb. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. You can see that the parable is an elaboration or an illustration of that proverb, because the very next verse, the beginning of the parable, Matthew chapter 20, verse 1, begins with for. Because. Okay, says, but many who are first will be last, for. And then he launches into the parable. And then all the way at the end, when he finishes the parable in verse 16, you wind up, he says, so the last will be first, and the first last. Which is a rephrasing of Matthew 19:30. Okay, so he's delineating, fleshing out, elaborating on, illustrating why he has said this idea, but many who are first will be last, and the last first. And so to whom does this proverb refer? What is the focus, or what is the object of this proverb? And I think the proverb in 1930s focused primarily on the rewards or privileges Christians will receive in the eternal state above and beyond eternal life. Okay? I think the focus of it is rewards Christians will receive in the eternal state above and beyond eternal life. I think it relates to Christians because Jesus is addressing his disciples. You see that in Matthew 19, 23. But more importantly, Peter's question, his question in chapter 19, verse 27, is about the rewards, the treasure in heaven that was mentioned in talking about the rich young man in verse 19, 21. You see, Peter's question here, his question is about the rewards that are in store for the 12 in light of the fact they had left everything to follow Jesus. Well, this is the treasures in heaven for him. What treasures in heaven will there be for us who have left everything to follow you? So Peter, following that, is talking about treasures in heaven. And Jesus' response in chapter 19, verse 28 and 29, he refers explicitly to those who have followed him and everyone who has renounced relationships and things for his name's sake. Okay, I'm explaining to you now why I think it's Christians that is the object of this proverb. Then you get to the proverb and it's connected to that with a conjunction, but. Okay, it's connected with that which naturally relates to the same group, namely Christians. So I think he's speaking here about Christians. And I think it relates primarily to rewards in the eternal state because Jesus told the rich man, he told that person, he said, that the surrender of his possessions would result in treasure in heaven, which suggests that something other than earthly life is in view. That's how you speak of that. You go ahead and do this and there'll be treasure in heaven. He's not talking about what he'll be receiving here, although we know that there's going to be blessings and things received here. But he's not talking about that to him. So that's the first thing about the idea that I think he's referring to the eternal state. And in reply to that, Peter said, they'd left everything, so what are we going to have? Meaning, following that, what are we going to have in heaven? But on top of that, and I think the most important thing and the clearest thing on this is Jesus says specifically, in the new world. He's talking about the eternal state. Jesus says here, truly I say to you that in the new world. Okay, this idea of the new world. Now, your translation may read, if it's a King James, an American Standard, New American Standard, it may read in the regeneration. Okay, meaning what? Meaning the regeneration of creation. Your translation may read, if it's a New Revised, NIV, TNIV, at the renewal of all things. But the point is the same. You see, this phrase is widely understood as a reference to the consummated kingdom, the eschatological hope of the new heavens and the new earth. This idea of the new world, the regeneration, the renewal of all things. What is he speaking of? He's talking about creation's ultimate makeover from Romans 8, when all that is contrary to God's eternal vision is stripped out. Now, I said that this is widely understood, so let me back that up. D.A. Carson, well-known New Testament guy, he says, here the word palingenesia has to do with the consummation of the kingdom. Craig Blomberg, New Testament scholar, he says, here the concept of regeneration or new birth reflects a completely Jewish background. Isaiah 65, 17, 66, 22, New Testament, 2 Peter 3, 10, all new heavens, new earth. Okay, he says, nothing less than new heavens and a new earth await Christ's followers after he returns in glory. Donald Hagner, palingenesia, which literally means rebirth or regeneration, refers here to the eschatological renewal of the world at the end of the present age. R.T. France, another New Testament scholar, he says, in 25, 31 to 46, the scene is apparently on the final judgment, and that eschatological perspective seems required here too, by the term, hey, palingenesia, the rebirth translated new age above, a term which aptly sums up the Old Testament eschatological hope of new heavens and a new earth. Okay, so when I'm talking about, I think he's referring to Christians, what they will receive in terms of rewards in the eternal state above and beyond eternal life. Part of it is, and a key thing is this idea of new world. That's where this is taking place. And so that's important, I think, to understand and hear the parable correctly. Now in Mark 10:30, I'm not going to get through this parable, but that's how it works. Then the question for me is, how much do I have to back up to bring us back to where I was? Anyway. Mark 10:30 and Luke 18:30. They make clear that the disciples will receive a hundredfold blessing in the present age. Okay, so we have Mark and Luke make that clear. And so that's, of course, true. But Matthew's omission of those words, see, it favors the notion that the emphasis picked up in the following parable is on their reward or privilege in the new world. You see, Matthew doesn't say that. And he's signaling by that what is happening and the focus of this parable is going to be on rewards in the eschaton. Rewards in the new world. Okay, I think that's important. Now, the enunciated principle, it would apply to rewards generally, now and in the consummation. I get that. Okay, that principle would apply generally, but he seems to be signaling that the parable's focused on the latter. All right, so that's all of this, I said, the context here. Jesus seems to be saying in Matthew, let me see if I got here. He seems to be saying in Matthew 19:30, yes, Peter, there are eternal rewards, treasure in heaven, for those who renounce worldly things and follow me. But those rewards often are allocated often will not be allocated in terms of human assessments of entitlement. Yes, there are rewards, but those rewards often will not be allocated in accordance with these human assessments of entitlement. On the contrary, reversals of expectation will be common. That's what this is. Many who are first will be last. Well, expectation is what? First will be first. Last will be last. But he says, there's going to be some reversals. There's going to be some surprises. Yes, there are going to be rewards that will be given. But something you have to understand is that they're not always going to follow human assessments of entitlement. So that human assessment would be first. But there are going to be occasions, you see, many who are first will be last. The expectations are going to be reversed. And that's what he's talking about there. So I think that's important. Now, I don't want to say a lot about the second part of 28 where he says, you who followed me, I don't want to explore that. You who followed me will also sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes. I don't want to follow that in any detail. Is that the first bell or second? All right. I don't want to follow that in any detail because it's not relevant to the parable. But let me just say that I think the idea is that at the consummation, when Jesus sits on his judgment throne, as you see in Matthew chapter 25, verse 31, the 12, as representatives of true Israel, as representatives of the Israel of faith. You remember, right? We have biological Israel, descendants, physical descendants, but within there we have true Israel, those who have the faith of Abraham, who are a subset of biological Israel. And then we have true Israel, and then grafted into true Israel, which are the Jewish descendants who accept God's word of the Messiah, who thereby show themselves to be people of the faith of Abraham, that subset of physical Israel. That's true Israel, and grafted into true Israel are the Gentiles, which creates new Israel. You see, that's the church. Okay, so what I think he's talking about here, these people as representatives of true Israel, the Israel of faith, and they may be even representing new Israel, the church, but they will in some capacity judge the unbelieving physical descendants of Israel for their unwillingness to believe God's testimony about his son. Okay, I think that's it, but that's all I want to get off on that. Now, I just get to read the parable, then the bell will ring. All right, so 26, all of that I said because I'm trying to set how I understand the parable. I at least want you, here's a guy, I think he's a physicist, a guy named Wolfgang Pauli, whose criticism of somebody, they had done something, a proof or something like that, and he said, that's not right, that's not even wrong. Okay, I always want to be clear enough so you can at least say, well, I think that's wrong. The fog stuff just drives me insane. So I do my best, so I want to at least, I had to give you the background so you will understand why I look at it the way I do, so then you're in a position to assess the strength of that. Okay, it begins in 20. He says, for, I underline that because, you know, now he's talking about what? He's talking about that little proverb that he had. For, the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them he said, you go into the vineyard too, and whatever's right I'll give you. So they went. Going out again about the sixth and ninth hour, he did the same. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, why do you stand here idle all day? They said to him, because no one has hired us. He said to them, you go out, you go into the vineyard too. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each of them received a denarius. Now, when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more. But each of them also received a denarius. And on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, these last worked only 1 hour, and you've made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I'm doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last worker as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do with what I choose, with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity? So the last will be first, and the first last. Now the hiring of these day laborers, this was something that would have been commonplace. But this repeated hiring throughout the day, this is simply part of the setup for the point of the parable. Okay, this would be very unlikely that an owner wouldn't have a better vision of his labor needs that he'd have to go out every time. Okay, but that's part of the setup, the structure of the parable. A denarius, this is an average daily wage for a worker. It's a modest amount. In fact, the cutoff typically for poverty at that time was 200 denarii a year. And Snodgrass says that that level of income would hardly do more than keep a family from going under. So maybe this is something like our minimum wage, although probably less given the differences in standards of living. There's the second bell. That's how it rolls. Thanks for coming.